Me too. Yeah, I remember everything started and it was kind of like, everybody was like, man, 2 weeks, that's a really long time to stay inside and not see your friends. And like, everybody was so bummed out and like 2 weeks seemed so crazy. And now it's, you know, it's like, you just kind of see your people in your pod, I guess, or whoever you live with, and that's it. And it definitely has changed. Obviously for you and I, you know, it totally changes how we work, and the whole trajectory of our industry is totally different. Even in studio world, you know, there's so much preparation now that has to go into like having a session. Everybody gets tests and like, it's crazy.
Yeah. Have you been recording then? Or have you just been like bedding? Because I've been bedding. I've been in the bed crew. I've just been like, I literally, all I do is watch How to Get Away with Murder and like rearrange my desktop.
Yeah, I mean, you know, I think for a while I was kind of just doing mixing for people because I can do it from far away, and we just send notes back and forth on email. And then as testing became more available, I started getting back in the studio with people little by little, and it still, you know, wasn't nearly as much as I would have liked to if I had planned on being off the road this long. But, you know, there's projects here and there that we kind of make it work, and we either all wear masks in the studio, or it's like, you know, there's a couple solo artists I've worked with where it's just me and the other person, and we can just be in my house and, you know, working on stuff.
It has become a thing where it's like the smallest thing you need to plan around so much. Like, even now when I get the mail, I like have masks by the door just in case, like tiny things. But it's already making me really appreciate very tiny things in the past. Like, oh, I remember when I got spots from using mics on tour. That was fun because I could touch my face on it. That was a good time. Should we start some questions?
Yes, let's do it.
My first, I've started writing it on legal paper because I'm watching a lot of crime shows and it makes me feel important. Like leafing through my docket pad, like, what's next? Yeah. My first question is super boring, but I really want to know because I just said I'm really like just watching telly and staying in bed and not really being a functioning artistic person at the moment. I want to know what the first 2 hours of your day generally are like. What do you do? Do you like run? Do you clean? Tell me.
I have tried running when I wake up. You know, I think the first half of quarantine, I really got settled into like chilling, and then like I was like, all right, I gotta do yoga, I gotta run, I gotta do something. So I try it. It's definitely not consistent. But usually what I do is I have always woken up super early, like no matter what time I go to sleep, it's just like something, my brain wakes me up early. So I wake up, I do the crossword puzzle on my phone. I have like the New York Times crossword app, which is like my way to like not look at Twitter first thing in the morning. But obviously I'm still like under a million covers, you know. I let the dog out, I make coffee, and then I've been trying to read for like 30 minutes or an hour every morning.
Smart.
Yeah, just to like get my brain moving, answer some emails, and then it's usually like 11 or 12 by the time I sit down at the computer to start mixing or you know, working on a song or whatever.
Yeah, the reading thing is something I implemented heavily during the summer period, because I have like this, it's not a roof garden, it's just like my downstairs neighbor's roof, and I use it as a garden. And I was like lying out there, I was having a shower and drying in the sun with a book, and it was amazing. But now that summer's ended, my mornings are less idyllic.
Cold over there? Is it like it's snowing horrible. Stuff yet?
It's so gross. It like gets light at like 10, if it gets light, and then it gets dark at like 3:30 or 4.
Oh my god!
And it's just raining constantly. It's horrible. Last night I had like a bit of a like, as something really minor happened, my boyfriend spilled some takeaway on me, and I, like, felt myself getting way more angry than I should have got. I was like, oh my god, I'm so furious! So I went for a walk, but I didn't look outside, and it was pissing it down, and I was walking around in the rain. And my pocket has a hole in it, and I have this, like, special little bag that I bought at Niagara Falls to keep my cigarettes in. And at some point on the walk, it must have fallen out of my pocket, and I got back, and I was soaking wet. And I realized that it was lost, and I went back out and like retrace my steps, but I couldn't find it. So last night I really was feeling shit about England.
Fuck this. Some seasonal depressive weather.
I got my mum a sad lamp actually for Christmas one year, and I think I should get myself one, because it really, like, a sunlight does affect me in a huge way, I've realized. Like, I don't tan, I don't like summer, because I don't come out of it looking like there's been a summer. I'm just pale all the time. But I realise that it gives me a reason to wake up. Like, recently I've been like, what if I just stay in bed till 4? It doesn't make any difference. Yeah.
Well, that kind of leads into a question I had written down.
Ooh.
Which is, if you could live anywhere else in the world other than where you live, where would you go?
I've been thinking about this so much recently. I've started learning French, and I really want to go live in Paris or Montreal, even though I know that it's not the same kind of French. I just have this idea that I want to live somewhere that feels more European than England feels, where I can speak French and work in a bookshop, and everything will just be a bit more like a book.
Yeah, I want to live in a book. Yeah, that's a pretty romantic... lifestyle.
Yeah, and it's like, it's so dumb that I've had like 3 years where I've been touring quite a bit, but maybe 4 months of the year I've been touring, and the rest I have basically got free time to go and travel or do whatever, and I haven't. And now the only time that I can't travel, I'm like, ooh, I really want to go places. So I'm kind of trying to switch off that part of my brain that's like, get out. But yeah, I mean, I was thinking about living in LA for a bit, but it freaks me out that it's like a city in a desert. I don't understand how it works. Like, you guys have droughts all the time, which makes sense because there's like thousands of people living in a desert.
Yeah.
It's like kind of like a dream world. It's strange.
Yes, it is. It is kind of like a dream world. It's definitely weird and wild and... You know, I mean, drought is something that I feel like I've been subconsciously aware of my entire life. Yeah. I think the last year or the year before was like the first year that Southern California was like fully out of drought. We got enough rainwater, or like Northern California was like sending down enough rainwater that we were like not in a drought. That being said, you know, I want to be conscious of how much water I'm using, but I've never been like unable to do something because of it, you know?
Yeah. Do you feel guilty if you have a bath? Are you like, ooh, maybe not?
I mean, it's definitely something I think about, you know, like,
yeah,
I don't do baths that often, or like for my whole life, like, you know, my parents had a lawn in the front and they would water it at like 3:30 in the morning. They had like the sprinklers on a timer because if you water it when the sun's out, then so much of it evaporates that it's like more of a waste than it is helpful to the grass.
I pictured your parents go like setting alarms and being like, time to go out with a cup of water.
No, we had like some sprinklers that just fired off, but I remember like waking up because I could hear the sprinklers firing off really early in the morning, and it's just like stuff like that, like preventative things that are like baked in, like, you know, I like turn the faucet on and turn it off while I'm brushing my teeth, and like,
oh yeah,
I've seen people just like leave it running, and I'm like,
no, that makes me so cross. And we don't even have water problems. There's almost too much water here. It's like, use whatever you want, it's coming all the time.
Yeah.
We're soaked. Yeah. My next question is probably completely unrelated. Oh, this is something I personally couldn't answer because I don't remember. But do you know what your earliest memory is?
Whoa.
Or maybe just a early memory.
Yeah, an early memory.
It's hard to know where memories sit and whether they're real or whether you've just looked at a photo or like been reminded of something by someone else. I was trying to remember like preschool years and being like, I feel like I only know that that happened because there's a photo of it. Like, I don't actually know what's a real memory anymore.
Yeah, I kind of feel like that too, like about birthday parties and stuff, where I'm like trying to remember if I remember the feeling or not. I was just, you know, it was just like, it's holiday season. So like, I was just remembering that my cousins and my family, and then several other sort of like cousins of cousins, used to get together for Hanukkah. Mm-hmm. And there was like 8 or 10 kids, all sort of like between, you know, 4 and I don't know, maybe 9. Mm-hmm. And like, I remember there's a photo of all of us like sitting on a wall outside of my great uncle and then some of those kids' grandfathers' apartment, like a photo of all of us. And I remember recently being in that, my great uncle's apartment, and like just the immense anxiety of getting a Hanukkah gift that I didn't know if I liked or not. It was like this crazy anxious memory that popped into my brain recently, where I was like, because you know, I'm like thinking about getting Christmas gifts for everybody, I'm like trying to figure out what everybody wants and my family, whatever. And I was like, man, I think I've always been anxious about gift giving and getting, and like,
yeah,
I just had this horrible feeling where I was like, oh god, like how am I gonna act
if I don't like say
thank you as like a 5-year-old or whatever if I don't like whatever's in this box, you know?
I get anxious around anything where I'm expected to be enjoying it, like any birthday, any Christmas, any like school holiday. I was like, fuck, what if I don't enjoy it? But most of all, what if I do enjoy it and nothing ever lives up to how much I'm enjoying it, etc. I think those anxieties never really leave, which is a shame, because I'd like to just enjoy things and be able to not enjoy things and let myself off the hook for not enjoying them. But I definitely get that gift thing. What's the worst present you've had to pretend that you like?
I feel like I've gotten some clothes in the past where I'm like clothes is one of those things where it's just like, I would rather just somebody hand me a gift card or like 30
money.
Bucks. Or
just
whatever.
The money, like, would be good.
Yeah, exactly. Like, here's 30 bucks, get a new sweater, whatever.
Yeah.
And I think that people, when they're like trying to like anticipate what my taste is, it doesn't really work out so well, especially when I was younger and I just, you know, I feel like I was pretty like, I don't know, I just feel like I wasn't like really an adventurous like outfit wearer. I still am not really. And you know, I think people would get me like a shirt with like something on it they thought was cute, and I was like,
you know. Thanks.
Yeah, especially like, you know, people like that were outside of my
immediate family.
Your family, exactly.
I feel like clothes are always a no, unless it's something really specific or really broad. Like if it's just like a really horrible jacket with like loads of feathers on, that's probably a good shout, because no one's gonna like it and everyone's gonna think it's funny. Never go for something like just like a staple. Don't get someone like a turtleneck or like a t-shirt.
It's just weird. Yeah. It's like begs for like you to sort of go through the mental like exercise of like, oh, this person had to like think about what size I am, or like,
oh yeah,
you know what I mean? There's just like so many things baked into it, and you're like, ah, I just would have loved to check.
Yeah, I've got some like inappropriately timed underwear from my parents before, like before I was sexually active. I would get like black pants from my mom and be like, thanks. And then when I hit like 16 and I had a boyfriend, she would get me like horrible like female boxers and stuff, like really unsexy pants. I was like, the one time I maybe want my bum to look good, and you've just gone the whole other way. Maybe it was on purpose for her to be like, be safe, put these horrible pants on.
That's funny. Yeah, I used to hate gifts like that, like underwear and socks. And then once I was like, I feel like when I when I graduated college, like 22, all of a sudden I was like, yeah, I love socks. I'm like, give me underwear. I need all that stuff and I don't want to buy it.
Me too. Like something like a, like kitchen shit. I would love it if someone bought me like really nice pans now, but no one will. People will buy me like a spatula shaped like a guitar just because it's shaped like a guitar, but nothing like actually practical. That's another thing, like being, having a specific job that people kind of characterize by the title of the job. Maybe it happens to accountants where they get like a pencil case with numbers on it, but it definitely happens to musicians where you get like a microphone shaped hairbrush and you're like, thanks, I love it. I love microphones.
Exactly, yeah. So, and also, I mean, I feel like, you know, if you're going for like a practical gift, like any of the stuff that you or I probably would want that would be useful for a musician is like way out of the price range of like what someone should be getting you for a gift, you know, like, like I want like new microphones and like a new guitar and like stuff that I just need to save up for and eventually, you know, invest in.
Or just capos, like I lose capos. So frequently, like just give me like a jumbo pack of capos and I'm gonna be happy.
It's actually a great gift.
Yeah, maybe I should get that for myself.
Yeah, there you go, there you go. Okay, I have the this is one of my favorite questions of all time.
Okay.
What is your favorite compliment that you've ever received?
Ooh. Wow. I don't know if it's a, it was more of like an action that someone did that made me feel appreciated and seen. And it was when I first, I've told this story so many times, but it's honestly one of the most touching things that's ever happened to me. And it seems like it shouldn't have touched me so deeply, but it did. I was dating this really awful guy who was really controlling and really scary. And I found it really hard to say no to him because he was like, he like pushed me around and he just wasn't cool. And Lucy Dacus was in the UK and she came out with us to the pub. And this boyfriend was being really like pushy and making me, like trying to make me leave because he wanted to go home. And Lucy, who I'd only met one time, came up to us and saw that he was being a dick and like took his shoulder and like moved him away from me and was like, don't treat my girl like that. And I was like, fuck.
Damn.
That was so cool. And none of my actual, like, long friends had done anything. I think it took a fresh pair of eyes to be like, taking the fact that I don't really know either of those people out of the situation, like, that's not how you treat someone.
Yeah.
And to me that was, yeah, really helpful and made me feel like I was worth more than the thing that was happening to me. And then shortly after I broke up with him, when I was on tour with her, because I felt like safe in her kind of comforting
embrace. Yeah, Lucy is a hero in that way. I think that she's really like good about realistically seeing a situation. And that's something we have common is I supported Lucy on tour also in the US.
Right.
I know y'all backed her up in Europe, in the UK.
Yeah.
And yeah, she has a real, like, you know, wise beyond her years sort of, like...
that wisdom,
of moving around the world, and it's really, really cool. And that's awesome. It's like a compliment without being a compliment.
I feel just her as a person, I was wondering for a while whether she's always been that kind of wise and... safe isn't the word, but... to be around her feels stable. It doesn't feel like she's wanting anything from a situation. She's just fully there and like will be honest with you. And I, for one of the tours I did with her, my tour manager was one of her best friends from when they were kids. And she was like, oh yeah, she's always been like that. She's always been this like kind of column of wisdom and someone you go to when you need something, and she's just there, which is really cool. I hope if I have a kid, it will end up like Lucy. Like, because I know I won't, so I just hope that I was, like, passed on.
Yeah. That wisdom can skip a generation, you know? Like, I'm not like that, but I do, you know, that sounds like the ideal kid is a kid like Lucy for sure. Question-wise, it's your turn.
My turn. I'm excited for this one, but I don't know if you'll have an answer for it. If you don't, it's fine. But I want to know what your school performance career was like. I'll explain. Okay. I was in drama club, like, religiously until I developed, like, puberty shame where I was like, ugh, no one look at me, and then I dropped out of drama club and I didn't want to be on stage anymore. But I was like really into drama club. I did jazz band. I wasn't allowed in choir because I wasn't loud enough, like my voice was too quiet. But I was really like into being on stage at school. Did you do like, were you in like school band and stuff? Did you like have a mime group?
I was in school band big time. I was like constantly weaseling out of other classes so I could take more band classes because I used to play drums. Nice. And so I was in jazz band on drums and I was in the orchestra or the wind ensemble. We didn't really have a lot of string players. So it was just a wind band, but like classical stuff on like percussion and like, whew. So I was playing all the sort of drummy, percussion-y instruments and mallets, you know, and like definitely deeply, deeply nerdy music, you know, like, yep. I had no idea I was on the radio in high school, like, because I was just listening to like academic music and like jazz and like stuff that I thought was like really heavy, you know, and like, and then like emo shit that like people weren't interested in my high school.
Just like the polar ends of music.
Like, yeah.
Fuck this is where it's at. Yeah,
but I definitely was like, you know, doing all the winter concerts and like doing like we had a pretty good theater department also at my mm-hmm. high school, and so I was in like the pit band, you know, like sick. Doing the music for the musicals, like,
well, like live music for the plays. That's awesome.
Yeah. It was pretty cool. It, you know, I just went to public school, but they happened to have a pretty good music department that was like well supported by the parents. So it was really nice. But yeah, I didn't do anything cool. You know, I wasn't like in a cool rock band that was like playing all ages clubs. I was like playing dorky music.
Yeah, I'm so jealous of those people. Like, yeah, my first band, I was like 12. It was cool. Like, I've never had that.
You know, I don't know. I mean, I think in middle school, I had a band that wanted to be like a Green Day cover band. And we played like one song. And I don't even remember what song we learned. But, you know, we never like played out. We like played in my parents' garage once or twice.
Yeah.
So it was pretty, yeah, nothing notable that wasn't extreme nerd zone as far as like stage career.
So cute. Did you have nativity plays? This is just an add-on question.
I didn't, because in public school, and you know, it was like, yeah, we didn't really do like anything that was religious adjacent. Yeah.
I wish that we didn't, but we did. I went to there's like two types of school in Britain. It's like three. You either go to private school, and you get like a non-religious education, or you go to just general public school, and then you have some kind of religious leaning, or you go to Steiner school, which is really expensive, but you get to learn like juggling, and I didn't get that privilege because my parents weren't rich, so I went to a Christian school, and we had nativity plays, and every year I was something like a tree, like a palm tree or like the back of a camel, and one year I was like maybe 10 and I was getting really down about the fact that I never got a speaking role. And I was a tree that year, and I didn't get to be Mary. And my mum was like, well, Fen, if there weren't any trees, Mary wouldn't be able to breathe, let alone give birth to Jesus. And I was like, yeah, you're right. Actually, I fucking rule. And the whole time I was doing the play, I was like, I'm the best.
The unsung hero.
Yeah, just like applauding myself inside my little fucking papier-mâché trunk.
Oh my god, I love that. That's so cute.
Really smugly bowing at the end. Everyone else is like being modest and a child, and I was like, yes, I deserve all of this praise.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
Luckily I wasn't pushed into. I think if I had to do on stage acting, I think I would have a full meltdown. I don't know why. I just like wouldn't. I wouldn't be able to deliver, you know.
It's a weird thing. There are some things you're just expected to be fine with when you're a kid. Oh, there's the dog. Hello.
Yeah.
Is she okay?
I think she's okay. She probably just is hearing somebody moving around.
Does she attack postmen and stuff? Mailmen?
Not really. She gets a little, she barks a little bit when, like, somebody comes in that, like, you know, she didn't know was going to show
Fair
up.
Fair enough.
But, come here. I left the door open for her so she could come in. Oh, okay. Question.
Yeah,
how would you tell your 12-year-old self about what you do, and how do you think your paradoxical younger self would react?
When I was 12, I was doing piano lessons with my friend's dad, who was one of the coolest people because he was like a mad professor of music. He just like lived in the living room of their house and made songs for TEFL, which is like speaking English as a foreign language. So he'd like make songs to teach like Spanish kids how to speak English and stuff. And I thought he was the coolest guy, and he'd give me piano lessons after school. And I really wanted to be a musician, but at the time I didn't realize that piano like wasn't my thing, and I wasn't going to be good at playing Chopin. So I think if I knew when I was 12 that I would be a musician but I wouldn't have to read music, I'd be psyched. But often I realized that something really cool has happened to me that my younger self would be really impressed by. But now, because it's happening now, I don't really see it as a success. I see it as like just something that happened and someone higher up is doing something more impressive. So I wish that I could tell my younger self that what I'm gonna do is gonna be cool, but give myself permission also to be stressed out by it. Because I think when I was that old, I was like, musicians just have the coolest life. It's like the easiest thing. People want to hear what you make, and that's that. But recently I've been finding it a bit more stressful. Releasing the album was really stressful. So I'd warn myself that it was going to be up and down, and that's okay. But at the same time, I think I would be psyched. But I never really had, like, I don't know about you, but I never really knew what I wanted to be. I didn't really have any things I was super good at. I was kind of good at most things, but not great at anything. So I didn't really have anything that I was throwing myself into passionately. Were you a kid that was like, I know exactly who I'm going to be?
Not really. I always knew it was music, you know, but when I was a kid, I didn't realize that there was a whole studio career you could have.
Yeah.
And I thought you were either like a performer or like a manager. Like those are like in my mind the only two things. And I just didn't really understand like about record making or anything. And sometime, I don't think it was even until college, maybe senior year of high school, I was like started reading the back of reading liner notes really obsessively. And I was like, oh, you know, there's like a producer job where you can be really creative. You don't have to be managing people in the way that a manager or an agent would. And you also, the pressure's kind of off as far as like coming up with songs or like, you know, being on stage. I never thought I would be performing as in the way that I do now, but, yeah, it took me a long time to sort of realize what the path was, although the whole time it was kind of like music, undoubtedly, in some way. Yeah. And I don't know, I just like, there was nothing else that I was really interested in. I was really bad at sports. I was really good at school, but I didn't care about it. Like, I didn't really try very hard, and I just kind of breezed through it. And music was always really very exciting and challenging, but not in a way where I like couldn't get to the place I wanted to be ever, you know?
Yeah, production is something I've never even, I mean, I think about production when it comes to choosing a producer.
Mm-hmm.
Although when I made the demos for this last record, I did teach myself how to use software and like did it by myself at home just to like map everyone's stuff out, because I'm a control freak and I don't want to just let a drummer do their thing. I like have to know what's happening. But production, like, it's so impressive to me that somebody who isn't the musician can see a bunch of songs and be like, I know what to do with this. I know how to make a story that makes sense in sounds. It's so cool to me. What's the last record that you worked on that you're really like jazzed to work on?
So there's one that I just was in New York in November, which I don't know if I'm allowed to say who the band is, but it's coming out at the top of 2021. And it was just, it was a really exciting experience. It was kind of like one of the first records that was already at a certain level of like, you know, budget and visibility and whatever that I had completely on my own. I used to be an engineer for this other producer who worked on a lot of great stuff. But you know, it was all his projects and I was there to engineer and do whatever. But this was like the first one where I was doing everything, producing, engineering, and mixing, and getting paid what I wanted to be getting paid for it, and sort of knowing that it would reach a certain amount of people. So that was a really fun project. And then the other project that's been going on lately is with my friend Lou. Her project's called Lou Roy, and she put out an EP like a year or two ago with a major label, and like then that relationship sort of ended. And she's coming back with a full length that we've been working really hard on, and it's been really rewarding to take her songs that are so fantastically woven together and really put them on the next level and kind of do exactly what you said, like figure out what the sonic story is for some of these songs. And you know, in both projects, that they were both so different, and both artists sort of had a vision or like a road that they wanted to travel, but I think from beginning to end was the missing piece in both of those albums. And so it was really cool to kind of string together like the heart of the song with like the record, you know what I mean? Like the one people are gonna hear.
Do you think being close to someone personally helps draw that line production wise
In some cases, in some cases, you know, I think there are some friendships that work really nicely, and like some friendships make great working relationships, and will, you know, in those cases usually there's a lot more trust. Like the person will be like, oh yeah, I know you, and like I know you're gonna get it done, so like chase this idea, and I'm not gonna weigh in until you're done figuring it out, and then I'm gonna say if I like it or not. In the other cases, I think it can get a little muddy, just because like also if you're working with your friends, they're not afraid to sort of like jump in, and like there's not necessarily professional boundaries at play. So I don't know. It sort of depends from project to project. I haven't worked on anything yet that's ruined a friendship. So
yeah, that's fingers crossed. I guess it's more it's like personal chemistry more than intimacy, I guess.
Yeah, totally. For sure. Yeah, being a producer is a very, very weird relationship, because you do sort of become very intimate with a person and with all of the sort of like most vulnerable parts of somebody's personality. But sometimes you don't know that person very well in reality, you know?
Yeah. It's so weird. When I was making this record, my producer was, he's called Brian Deck, and he's in Chicago. And there were times when I was like rebelling against him because he was the age of my parents and a guy, and I was like, feels like you're being my dad right now, like I hate this. Realistically, he just had in mind the best thing for the music, and he wasn't making the same like parental comparisons that I was. But there were times when I was like, fuck you don't understand. And I think, I mean, we made a record that I like, and I don't have anything bad to say about him, but I think it is more of a relationship that can go south or can be really fine, and it just really depends on the people that are within that relationship. It's a tricky thing. I think, I don't want to admit it, but I think my ego is too big to be a producer. I feel like I'd be like, oh, this song's so good, I'm really angry that it's not mine, or like, this song sucks, I'm not making this song.
It's like, really hard. Like, it's so hard to check your ego, and even on like a more microscopic level, you know, like you, as a producer, you have just like so much more perspective in some cases, than an artist, and you do sort of like, you can see what the best version of the song is, but often that's not the version that makes the artist most happy, and you're also playing with that, and so you have to sort of check your ego and be like, okay, I know I can make this into the greatest song in the world, but in reality, that's not what Fenn wants.
Yeah.
So
Fenn wants it to be the worst song in the world.
Yes. I have to make that happen. So, and you know, that's part of the project too. And like, if all you care about is making the greatest song in the world, then you're not really in the business of collaborating, because you have to deal with other people's opinions and perspectives, and you have to deal with somebody who's been probably living with the songs for maybe years longer than you have, you know.
Yeah.
Like, if you have a song that you wrote 2 years ago and you know all the ins and outs, and I'm like, we gotta make this into a Nirvana song, and you're like, hell no, then like, you know what I mean? Yeah. Like, there's a you have to trust each other on like what is good for the song versus what is good for everybody's personality.
Yeah.
You know,
it is kind of like being a parent in that respect, I guess. Like, having a kid and you're like, but I know you'll be great if you do these classes. And the kid's like, I don't want to. And you just have to be like, okay, you know you more than I do. I'm just here to facilitate. And, yeah.
Exactly.
Yeah.
Very wild.
I can't remember what I last asked you.
I think I asked about if you could ask your 12-year-old self.
Oh, yeah.
Or tell your 12-year-old self what you did. So
I'm just picturing myself at 12. I was doing martial arts and I had basically this hair, but I didn't have like eyebrows or like eyelashes or anything, and I was awful. I looked awful. There's a group picture of my like martial arts team, and there's like 30 of us, and I found it the other day, and I was looking through and I was like, where am I in this photo? I like went through the whole crowd, and then right at the end I was like, there I am, and I don't know how, but I'm like falling, but we're all kneeling down, so I don't know how I'm falling. I'm like falling, and I'm like, and that's the photo that they picked, and it's like a bit blurred. I look like a piece of bread with like kind of some kind of hairdo. It's very funny. It's like childhood wrapped up into one photo. I have a specific question for cheese, the person, not the food. Is one of my favorite titles. Also, you have a lot of brilliant song titles, just as a rule. So good. What's my favorite one is something like, am I allowed to title a song, if you were a guy, you'd be the worst guy? That's not the song. It's the first track on the record.
Will I get cancelled if blah, 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 blah.
So good. I was like, it's such a long sentence and it works so well.
Thanks.
My question is, in For Cheese,
yes,
you talk about sleeping in your car on your birthday. What is your worst birthday memory? / if you don't want to go negative, what's your best birthday memory? But I feel like best is less fun, so.
Best is way less fun. No, I mean, best is like, yeah, best is way less fun. Worst, that was definitely one of my worst birthdays, man. I mean, it was pretty... I was just like really heartbroken, you know, I was like really caught up in this heartbreak, heartachey situation. And I had a really great birthday evening, and I just got way too drunk and like maybe kissed some people I didn't mean to, and like was really embarrassed. And then I like stayed at my friend's apartment like on his couch, and then I woke up really early and I like walked to this taco place to get a breakfast burrito, and I like took one bite and I was like, oh my god, I think I'm gonna throw up. I was like so hungover, and I was like too embarrassed to like go like ask my friend what he was doing the rest of the day, just because like the night felt so messy and confusing. And I just like went to where my car was parked, and I like laid down in the back seat, and I like just tried to like even out so I could drive home. And it was pretty gnarly, but like now looking back on it, it seems hilarious to me, you know, like I remember somebody handed me a $10 bill, and there was like, you know, it's like a virtual jukebox that they like have on the walls and bars, and I put on Mariah Carey's Emotion 10 times in a row.
All my money on one song.
That's yeah, so and so good. I just, like, played on loop in the bar for, like, 20 minutes. So that was the best $10 I ever spent, also. Yeah.
It's so, the best $10 I've ever heard anyone else spend, also.
Yeah. So I was really pumped, and it, like, came on, and I was like, that's the song I picked. And then it, like, immediately started over, and I was like, I did it again. So yeah. It was pretty fun.
I think the worst nights are the best stories, which is a shame, because I've had some brilliant birthdays and brilliant, like, nights out, but they're never the ones that I remember. Like, the worst Christmas I ever had is the only one I ever bring up to my parents. I'm like, remember that Christmas where we didn't have any money and we sat on some skateboard ramps and ate pasta and then went to bed early? And they're like, what about all the fucking stockings and, like, all the brilliant times? I'm like, yeah, fuck those. Remember that one?
Yeah. Yeah, it's the same with tour, right? Like, all the places you remember are, like, the grimiest, like, grossest houses you stayed in, or, like, the bar that you played where there's, like, no door on the toilet stall, like, yeah. All, you know, those are the shows and the memories that really stick out with
yeah it's such
tour.
A shame. Yeah, recently I did an interview for some radio station and they were like, they sent me all the questions and I just didn't look at them because I was like, I can wing it, and I mainly did. And then they were like, what's the best venue you've ever played? I was like, fuck, I just can't remember any venues. I can only remember the really shit ones, and that wasn't the question. I really feel
totally,
bad.
Yeah, I mean, unfortunately, you know, when you play a great show at a totally normal place and everything went totally the way it was supposed to, you're just kind of like, all right,
cool,
see ya
bye.
At the end of the night. That's like the end, you know, there's nothing crazy that happens.
I get, maybe it's the same for everyone, but maybe it's the fact that as people who have to write about stuff that, not don't have to, but your music's diaristic to an extent, mine definitely is. Everything's just like, this happened, then this happened, then I was sad. I think I've kind of trained myself to only retain things that will be useful artistically, and those are mainly bad things. I think it's part of my, like, psyche that I've created for myself now, where I'm like, oh, that's going on the list, you hurt me, write about that later.
Exactly. I mean, so that actually leads really nicely into a question I've written down.
Wow.
Which is, under what circumstances do you feel like you create your best work? Meaning, you know, is there, like, a time pressure element that helps? Is there, like, any kind of, like, observational data that, like, feeds into your writing? Like, what circumstances, what's, like, the perfect storm for, like, making a song that you're really proud of?
I think recently I haven't been writing a lot because I haven't had the opportunity to see my normal way of living in a different, from a different perspective. I think I need polar ends of an emotional spectrum. I need to feel either elated or depressed, which is a real shame. And when I want to write, I can never write. When I'm like, I've got 2 weeks to myself, I could bash out some songs now, it never happens. Ideally, I need to have just had a conversation or a fight with someone that makes me see myself from a third person perspective. Like, arguments are really useful for me. Like, the day after an argument, I'm like thinking about things I don't normally think about. I need it to be completely dark. I need a window.
Like, lights off?
Yeah, like, just nothing. I started writing for the first time last week. I've had, like, the most insane writer's block where I've basically been blaming the situation in the world, but realistically it's just because I got lazy. But I started writing last night, and my brother, fuck, that was a horrible Freudian slip, I meant my boyfriend. we'll edit it in post. My boyfriend's got an auto harp, and I find that I get into habits with the guitar where I just will play the same chords because I can, and I don't push myself to learn other stuff. But with the auto harp, it's just buttons and strings, and I don't know what's going to happen when I press a button because I don't know what a D minor 7 sounds like, and it's next to a chord that wouldn't be next to it in the guitar situation. So I was messing around with this instrument, and I had, like, my laptop recording, I had my phone with headphones, and I was, like, mumbling shit, and then I had a pad where I was writing. So I think I need to like spread out big time and like
Nice.
be. It would be ideal to like have a room mic in my house all the time so that when I'm like on the toilet, it just is catching what I'm singing. Because often I'll have a brilliant idea and then when it comes to thinking about it and like re-articulating it, it all gets lost. I wish I could just like press record on my brain or like spy on myself with like house cams. But yeah, the time pressure thing though, I can't do it. I can't be like, I've got a week to write this song and it has to be done. And I wish I was more prolific. I don't know how many songs you average in like a, it's like bench presses. What do you press, dude? But I mainly write when I am on tour or I've come back from tour because I'm thinking about myself more and I'm thinking about how the world sees me and how I see the world. But if I like have a month to myself, I'll probably just write like one guitar bit and then stress out that I haven't written more. How much do you write and how much do you think about writing?
Well,
Those
I
are
think
different
about
things.
writing constantly, and I have sort of been able to maintain that, like capturing any, like I like am obsessive about like voice notes and stuff, and I'll just constantly be like writing stuff down in my little notes in my phone or like in voice notes. I just put anything into there and like forget about it instantly, and kind of like try and compile everything when I need to, like, you know, when I need to be like turning in songs, then I sort of like have to sort through all the stuff. And it's good to just have those little like random things. Most of them are terrible. But every once in a while, it's like you'll just have like a piece and you're like, oh, that fits perfectly into this thing that like really doesn't have a bridge right now, or something.
That's so
So,
satisfying, that like Jenga of bits of music.
yeah,
So
it's
satisfying.
really been helpful. But I mean, I go through phases too, where it's like, especially with everything going on right now, you know, it's been so hard to be inspired. It's everything that I previously have written has come from also sort of either really emotionally charged situations or extremely observational situations in which I was like, just got back from tour. I have like this whole month of like crazy high octane stuff that just happened floating around in my brain, so I can like output a little easier. But yeah, definitely, you know, it's like this weird game, and this coming year, I want to be better about like being in the practice of writing. And I listen to, do you listen to Armchair Expert? It's a podcast with
No.
this actor Dax Shepard, and he interviews all sorts of people, but he just interviewed Shawn Mendes, who
Wow.
yeah, who I whose music I know almost 0% of. And he's, you know, he's a kid and he's obviously a pop star, but he talked about how a lot of writing is like turning on a dirty faucet, and you have to wait for all the dirty water to come out before the clean water
Shawn
comes out.
Mendes said this?
Yeah. And I
So
was like,
wise.
that's amazing. And I know. And like, people always say, like, oh, yeah, you should just write all the time because like everything's going to be shitty, but then like one in 10 things will be really nice and useful. But that's kind of a weird, pressury way to look at it, where what Sean said was just sort of like, you're never going to, you're just, you have to be flowing, or you're never going to find, you're never going to get into the rhythm, you know? That which made way more sense to me. So hopefully in the next year, I'll
That makes
try
a
and
lot of
sort of.
sense to me. I also feel like songs come in like teams, like families of songs. Like I won't write for 6 months and suddenly I'll have three that become the main songs on a record. It's weird how, yeah, I mean that is testament to the fact that you should allow yourself to flow like a dirty tap. Thanks, Sean. Yeah, for sure.
I
Damn, maybe I
don't
should
know. I
listen
mean,
to his music more. Maybe it would help me.
you know, I don't know. I mean, Shawn
Maybe.
Mendes' clean water looks a little different than ours, probably,
Oh,
but
it's so clean. It's so,
it's
it tastes
so
so
clean.
good.
It's completely
It's like sweet.
clean.
It's like bottled. Fuck him.
Exactly. But good advice, you know. Sean is obviously on some Zen tip that
Yeah, what's he smoking?
Right,
I want to join in.
Yeah.
Where did he get that face scar as well? I find nothing more sexy than a face scar, and he's got like a, maybe he's just shaved his eyebrow actually, but it's always there, so I feel like it might be a scar. It's got like a bit missing out of his face.
So I don't know. I honestly don't know if Shawn Mendes was standing in my room right now, I'm not sure.
He's there. He's been behind you this whole time, just waiting.
He's like, okay. I heard you talking shit.
I noticed. My next question to you is, if you were a teacher, what kind of teacher do you think you'd want to be, and what subject?
Whoa. I mean, I feel like it would be most natural for me to be some kind of production teacher at this point. Like, I feel like the last level in mastering something is being able to explain it to somebody else, you know? And like, that's not an opportunity that I'm given every day, is to be like, this is how I'm doing this. This is why I'm doing this. This is what, how I think about songs. That being said, I also think that like some kind of creative development class would be really cool to teach, like just kind of in any art medium, to be like, like, this is how you, like, sort of foster your creative habits and kind of, like, a very, like, holistic, like, Shawn Mendes way.
Mr. Shawn.
Yeah. Teach people how to, like, be confident in their creativity and, like, trust their instinct, which is something that I've run into a lot in as far as making other people's records, where sort of like at a moment of like when something just needs to be technically delivered, an artist will start to question their entire existential purpose, you know? Yeah. And they're like, well, if I can't sing this take, then I can't do this, then I can't do this, then what am I even doing in the studio? And like, how am I gonna ever show this to the label? And like, who's gonna wanna listen to this bullshit? And like, blah, blah.
Yeah.
Like, I would love to like build in to a class, like, how to like sidestep that, or just like be aware of what's happening, kind of like performance anxiety, I guess, but like in a less, like not as far as like being on stage or anything. Yeah. But like,
God, I wish I had that as an opportunity to choose that kind of teacher. I want you to do that just because I want to get you to help me.
God, yeah, so it's good. Hard. It's really hard. And like, it's definitely a natural part of the process. But I also, you know, when you're producing a record, there's like moments of creativity and magic that happen in every record. But 95% of the time is just like, here's the checklist. This is what, like, we need to do this guitar. We need to do this bass part. We need to sing all these background vocals. Mm-hmm. And it doesn't really matter if it's like the most inspired bass line you've ever played. You know what I mean? What matters is that it's sounds good. It's right. It's locked in.
And you feel
and then
about
maybe
it.
The next song, you could have an inspired bass take, you know?
Yeah. There's when you said the word holistic, I remembered that there's an X Factor audition that I love to watch where it's a woman, I think she's called Ariel something, and she was murdered shortly after she auditioned for X Factor, which seems suspicious to be linked.
That's
I think
crazy.
Simon Cowell did it, yeah. But she comes in and she's like got this whole attitude, and she like storms up and she rips her number off and she's like, firstly, I'm not a number, I'm a person. She slams the number down. Instantly, I love her. And then she's like, a little bit about me, I'm a holistic vocal coach. And Cher Lloyd's like, wait, what's she called? No, Cheryl Cole. Cheryl Cole's like, what does that mean? And she's like, when I coach vocals, I take into account someone's emotions, someone's lifestyle, someone's blah, 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 and all these things. And all these judges are like, what? And I'm on board because I'm like, all those things should be considered. Like, you're doing vocal teaching how I would want it to be. I've never had singing lessons, but if I had a holistic vocal coach that did all those things, I'd probably enjoy it. But then she fucks it up by doing this insane technical medley of all these different ways of singing. She does like some metal singing, she does some opera, she does some like weird rap, and then at the end they give her like bad feedback because it was bad, and she has this whole like she does this like, this like devil voice comes up from like the bottom of her soul, and she like shouts at all of them and has this tantrum, and they're like, well, obviously you're not gonna get on the X Factor, and she storms off. But I watch it all the time because I'm like, how can so many things be packed into such a small person in such a small amount of time? I'm gonna send it to you, but that's,
yeah, I gotta watch this.
That's how I imagine holistic teaching to be, but I still wanna partake.
Yeah, yeah, that's amazing. I mean, I wish we were all that unhinged that we could access all that stuff. Oh, yeah.
She's got these, like, white dreads as well. Like, she's crazy. She's so crazy.
Oh,
firstly,
no.
I'm a person, not a number. Storms off. So good. Oh, yeah. My final question, as you're in bed, what's your favorite element of bedding to be fresh? Do you, like, prefer your... Does that make sense?
Yeah, I think I'm pretty good about changing my sheets regularly. Yeah. And it starts to like creep me out if they've been like on my bed for more than a week, and I, whether they're actually need to be changed or not, I'm just like start to feel like everything is sweaty or something.
Yeah.
So I love just like making my bed completely fresh, taking a shower right before I go to sleep, and just like getting into like that's like the dream for sure.
I could easily just change my pillows and not the rest of it, because the pillow is the only thing I care about being clean.
I mean, that's important. That's definitely, you know, you gotta keep your face fresh, you gotta you know,
I could easily have like a year old duvet cover and be fine with it.
Yeah, duvet cover is the only one I'm not so great about, but all the sheets underneath I change frequently, and I don't like to eat in my bed, you know, like some people are like, I also like don't want to wear like pants that I've like worn into the world, like jeans that I've been like sitting on park benches with. I like don't want to put those inside my bed. I'll just like be like in sweatpants or like whatever, no pants mode.
No pants.
Yeah.
Yeah, that's smart. My bed's full of crumbs and tobacco and outside dirt, and I need to change that. Thank you so much for doing this. I've really enjoyed this one.
Yeah, thank you. I'm so glad we got to meet, and I love your music, and you know, I'm so stoked that you've had this cool little show. Thanks for asking me on.